Give it up for Mark Watson.
Cheers, Rob. Thank you, Rob. Hello, Rob.
And a man who is now as comfortable with a microphone in his hand as he is with a cue. Amazing to think, 36 years ago, he won the first of his 36 ranking titles. And just last week, a day after returning from China, he won the Snooker 900 live on Channel 5. He is an absolute legend. On and off the table, ladies and gentlemen, seven times he climbed the mountain in Sheffield, the one and only King of the Crucible, Stephen Hendry.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Thanks, everyone. Rob Walker, everyone, and thanks to him for reminding you of the much bigger crowds that will be here. Over the passes. At the back wall there, you can see me and Stephen depicted by local life. Very short notice commission. They did an excellent job, I thought. In case you're not aware, this is a recording of a podcast. It will be quite loose and like a real show, but occasionally there'll be bits where either we say things we've already said or it seems like I'm talking in quite a weird, stilted way. That's just because we'll have to say things like, for example, soon I'm going to have to say, good evening, I'm Mark Watson, welcome to the podcast. And you might well think, but we're already here. But for the purposes of the podcast, this isn't even happening. You're not here. Well, in those first couple of minutes, I will occasionally sort of force you to clap and cheer, basically. In fact, we'll do a practice one of those, just so that, well, so that you feel warmed up. This is not, I'd say it's not the most naturally warm space. For a start, it is literally, are you warm? It's warmer, you can chip in, yeah. It's, don't get me wrong, the rest of the building is freezing. Yeah, no, at least it is habitable in here, but like it is, in terms of a comedy. Are you, is it fair to say you're a big Stephen fan?
Absolutely.
I think that was a suspenseful pause. 10 seconds there where we all thought you were going to say, can't stand the man. Yeah, but in terms of a place to warm a crowd up, it's a slightly odd environment because you don't normally get classical murals for a start. So I'm going to, let's do a practice round of applause. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Snooker Room Podcast. That was good. I actually said the wrong name. It's called the Snooker Club, but that was clever. You ploughed through that. And if nothing else good happens in the podcast, they can use that as if it was real applause as well. So in a second, I'm going to actually start things. We're going to be chatting about the Masters. There'll be a chance to get involved, ask some questions, which the majority of them will go to Stephen, I sense. We've got at least one special guest, and by at least one, I mean two. One of them is a famous snooker fan, one of them is a snooker player that's here at the Masters. Anyway, we'll cover all this on the podcast, but I'm just letting you know, this will be quite good, I think. Which, I mean, I can't sell it any harder than that. And if nothing else, we hand over to this woman and she yells at Hendry for a bit. So, I said if nothing else, though. Let's try and stick to plan A for the time being, yeah. I know you're from Glasgow, yes. I've been to Glasgow, there was never any doubt. Are you guys ready? I wouldn't say happy, but yeah. Yeah, all right, great. Here we go. Hello, good evening, I'm Mark Watson, and welcome to a very special live edition of Snooker Club at Alexandra Palace! We've got a packed show for you this evening, and we can't get started without introducing my co-host. That would be rude, whoever he was, but especially in this context, because my co-host, of course, is none other than seven-time champion of the world, Mr. Stephen Hendry.
Good evening, everyone.
It's fantastic to be here at the Ali Pali on the eve of the Masters. Looking forward to a great evening.
Yes, we'll be obviously looking ahead to the Masters, and we're also joined in a little while by broadcasting legend, Mr. Stephen Fry. We'll also be joined by one of the players hoping to lift the trophy here at Ali Pali. We'll be taking questions from our live audience. We'll see how good an idea that is. The script says they look ready to go. That's an understatement in some cases. So without further ado, welcome to Snooker Club Live from Ali Pali. How are you doing? I mean, you know this place pretty well, Stephen.
Well, I actually didn't play here. I know it well, obviously working for the BBC and being here as a pundit and commentator. But
it was Wembley in your day.
Yeah, it was the conference centre, which held incredibly 2,750 people. I actually won it 6 times, 5 in a row.
We know that, Stephen.
Sorry to bring it back to me, but the only one that I'm famous for is the one that I lost in a black ball to Mark Williams.
Yes. Although, and I don't know how many people here remember this, but one of my memories of you winning the Masters at Wembley was that match against Mike Hallett.
Where
you were unbelievably far behind.
And I was 7-0 and 8-2 behind. That was for 3 in a row.
Who remembers Hendry destroying Mike Hallett?
But the worst thing about that story is not only did I come back from 8-2 to beat Mike 9-8 and sort of devastate. I think he'd lost 9-0 the previous year to Steve.
He'd been whitewashed by Steve Davis.
Yeah.
He comes up against Hendry. Imagine being 8-2 up, and he'd not won many majors either.
He'd won one or two tournaments, but
he could have really done without you ruining his life.
He could have done without it. But also he found out that his house was broken into that night as well.
What?
That's the worst part about that story.
Were you behind that as well?
Interesting. No. No, not at all. But I mean, I imagine you lost that family, but your house has been burned. I mean, I shouldn't be laughing. Why am I laughing? I mean, it's pretty horrendous. But
he would have got into the car home thinking, well, that's the worst thing that's going to happen to me today, at least.
That was a pretty memorable final.
Yeah, memorable break-in as well, by the sound of it. So he only found that out when he'd come off after this devastating...
We were actually back in the hotel having a few drinks after it, and he got a call. Yes, his house has been broken into.
That's a tough night. Anyway, great tournament.
The start off, it can all be cheery from here on in, can it, after that story?
What are your memories of playing it at Wembley? Did anyone go to the original, the Masters at Wembley?
Incredible venue. As I say, 2,750 people. I suppose the memorable matches there, obviously playing Jimmy White, because you're playing Jimmy White, a Londoner, in front of pretty much 3,000 Londoners.
Yeah.
So it's pretty safe to say that I didn't have the majority of the support.
When did you, Jimmy?
Well, exactly. I remember one time, I think I beat him 2 or 3 times and he beat me a couple of times. But I remember one of the times he beat me, he's potting the final balls and I could hear this, shall I do a Cockney accent? He's potting the last few balls and all I hear, I'm in my chair, already miserable, as you can imagine. I mean, I was miserable when I was winning, but yes. I was already miserable.
Slightly more miserable than usual.
Taxi for Hendry.
Yeah, the support for White was always quite a thing.
It was incredible.
Wembley must have been incredible, yeah.
It was, I think here we've got pretty much close to 2,000 people. I think I never thought they would ever replace that venue as a venue for the Masters. But now this Ali Pali is, the atmosphere is just phenomenal.
I was here last year and it was...
Isn't it good?
It was phenomenal.
Yeah.
I was here seeing last year. It was amazing. I've never...
It is a fantastic atmosphere. Do you feel like people here are a bit more kind of uninhibited in the crowd?
Yeah, I think definitely when you
play... Well, I mean, some people obviously,
But I mean, this lady's obviously from north of the border, but I mean, when you play tournaments here in London, for some reason, they're definitely more vociferous. They're definitely more... they get involved more, so.
Is it maybe because the Crucible is a theatre, so it has that slightly reverent atmosphere?
I think so. I just think there's something about this tournament down the years that's just... It brings that. It's just a completely different atmosphere to any other tournament, and in a good way. And what obviously, you know, World Snooker and everyone's done in terms of the first snooker event I've ever been to. It's actually got posh seats, and you've actually got like a VIP where you can have food and drink. I mean,
It's dangerous treating snooker fans like human beings, but yeah, it could still catch on.
It's incredible.
So if we go back to your earliest memories, it was your winning streak was 89 to 93,
yeah.
Is it?
Yeah. Yeah.
But when was your first one then? I mean, your first time you played in the Masters.
That was 89. The first time I played, and I won it.
Won it at the
Thanks
first
time. Thanks for
bringing time. That up. That's fine. So you won five on the bounce, having not played the Masters before.
Yeah. It was.
I mean,
it was very unusual for a Scotsman to have such success at Wembley. I would dare to say.
Yeah. Presumably, you didn't smash the goalpost up and carry them off like in the 70s.
I just loved the tournament. I loved the fact that it was the top 16 players in the world. So
yeah.
You're pitting your wits against the other best players. It was in an incredible venue, and yeah, I just felt so at home at the Wembley Conference Centre.
There's not many people you could ask this question to. How does it feel winning it compared with the world's?
Different. The World Championship is the sort of, when you start playing snooker, it's the ambition to be world champion. It's the sort of the pinnacle of being a snooker player. The Masters, I always sort of had, for the season ahead, goals. It'd be the World Championship would be first and the Masters would be second. The World Championship because it is at the Crucible, it's the World Championship. The Masters because it's against the other 15 best players in the world and you want to prove that you're better than them.
Yeah. And so you won it, John Parrott, the first time.
Yeah.
And yeah. The nerves, are they comparable to being at the Crucible, or is it more like you already know you're one of the elite because you're playing here at all?
Yeah, yeah. And I think part of being a top player is the nerves go. You're obviously nervous. You had to walk actually up. It was a weird venue actually because you had to walk upstairs to get into the arena.
Yeah.
And then you walk in and it's just this huge, huge place.
Yeah.
And you obviously have to walk so far from your seat to the table as well. It was just, everything about it was huge. And obviously then it was tobacco sponsored, it was Benson Hedges, which is weird because people still come up to me sometimes and say, when's the embassy? When's the Benson Hedges? It's so weird, it's like so long ago. But
yeah,
so it was very, you know, it was such a prestigious event. It felt prestigious.
Some of you might be too young to remember, but at one time snooker was entirely sponsored by stuff that would kill you. And
I've never had one drag of a cigarette in my life as well.
Yeah, they didn't get to you, did they?
They didn't get to me.
It is a special place. Obviously, some of you might have seen the darts last week. That shows you a different side to Ali Pali.
Great clear up they've done anyway, isn't it? That must have taken a bit of a.
Christ knows how this place is even fit for people to set foot in now after the. Yeah, it'll be a slightly different atmosphere from that, I would imagine. So, Stephen, obviously this year's Masters is upon us. Mm. Well, we've heard Rob Walker say, every time Davis is asked, he just says, no idea who'll win, they're also good. But that's not punditry. So, anyone here could say, no idea.
Yeah.
So, let's put you on the spot a bit. Have you got a winner in mind?
I think, first of all, I think it's very difficult to make a case for Ronnie not winning it, because I think the way he played in the UK, what's different about Ronnie now, I think, is he used to be all about the performance. He used to say, I'd rather play well than win.
Yeah.
Now it's the opposite. He'd rather win. It's all about the result, and that makes him such a dangerous opponent.
Yeah, the last thing you want is O'Sullivan trying to win.
Yeah. I think if he...
It's bad enough when he's just pissing about.
He'll be favourite and for good reason. Judd Trump has obviously had an amazing season, but I think
Trump is the holder, isn't he?
Yes. Yeah, you're right. Yeah, beat Mark in the final
Williams
last year.
Yeah, yeah.
I understand what Steve's saying, but it's, you know, it's nonsense, really.
Yeah. Yeah. Like everything else that
typical
comes out of
Steve to take the easy way out.
Really?
Typical Steve. They make no effort whatsoever.
No, too busy with his music.
I think there's the winner will come from maybe three or four players.
So are there some players that you reckon
aren't? It'd be very interesting to see how Neil Robertson plays.
Robertson remains a talking point, obviously.
Is he in it? Yeah, he must be in it, Neil Robertson.
It wouldn't be interesting if he's not in it.
Yeah, yeah.
It would be amazing if he won it, but he's not in it.
Yeah, because he's dropped so far down the rankings.
You have to.
There's a lot of tournaments he's not in.
It's amazing. You have to stop and ask yourself whether Robertson is still. Yeah. But he is. He's here.
He's been in Australia for the last 4 or 5 weeks.
Robertson's taken a break.
How he plays.
We were having the same conversation actually.
Yeah.
privately, yeah. Robertson is playing. I mean, it must be even after having had that break, it must be hard for him though, because you're playing in this level of competition.
Has he been practicing? That's the thing. Or has he just been surfing and feeding and feeding kangaroos?
Yeah.
Now that's not racist or anything. He actually posted a picture of him feeding himself feeding a kangaroo.
Many of you here will have seen the picture of Robertson feeding kangaroos.
He's not anti-Australian or anything like that.
To be fair, he hit the food into the kangaroo's mouth from somewhere away.
But I wouldn't put Neil as one of my favourites to win.
No, I mean, it's interesting, actually. We've talked about Robertson quite a bit on this podcast because of the sort of strange year that he's had. Was there ever a time when you felt you were, like him, playing too much, just burnt out? Did you ever wish that you could take a break? It's a bit different for him, of course, because part of his thing was he needs to go back to Australia. And
yeah. No, not really. But, I mean, there's a lot more snooker these days, obviously, than there was in the 90s, a lot more tournaments.
Yeah.
And how can I even begin to know how it feels like to... His family's the other side of the world, and he's living here. So I mean,
have you ever needed to feed a kangaroo? Or?
No, not really. It's not one of my life's ambitions.
No,
I have
exactly.
to say. It's not up there.
Just crack on without it. So you reckon they always say anyone can win this tournament, but you'd say probably not all 16.
I say yeah, three or four.
Ronnie and Judd are in opposite halves of the draw, of course.
Which would be an amazing final.
So that would be a hell of a final.
Amazing final. Mark Williams won in Macau over Christmas. Quality field, Ronnie was in it. Wazowski, Trump, they're all there. Mark won it. So he'll be full of confidence.
I mean, speaking of people that have got form winning tournaments, by the way, I don't know if you've ever heard the podcast, but a running theme of it, stroke joke, is that Hendry never plays anymore. And can't be asked, and he's more into golf, and he can't win a game to save his life. But many of you will be aware that over the Christmas period, he won the seniors tournament, which is...
Thank you very much, thank you very much. Yes.
We've had our fun with Hendry being shit, but he's back.
Yeah, great fun, great fun.
We'll have a moment where you can ask him questions, but... So, and that sort of ruined this whole strand of the podcast. The whole joke was that you just couldn't win the game anymore, but you not only won a match, but...
It was my inspiration for doing it. I thought, I cannot do this live podcast. I've got to come here as a winner.
So
I know how much pleasure you get by this constant...
I was gutted, yeah. Every day I put Stephen Hendry lost into the Twitter search bar. And it looked like real fun.
It was a great event. All obviously... Legends were there. Jimmy again in the final, which was great.
I mean, if you get Jimmy in the final, there's only one winner.
I mean, it's still a great buzz to play Jimmy in finals. I said at the time, he was my hero growing up when I first started playing snooker.
Until he ruined his life, obviously
we've had a huge history playing against each other at the Crucible and through the 90s and stuff. So it's always cool to play him in a final, and even cooler to beat him.
Well, he's not a sentimental man, Stephen. Well, what's it like between you? Do you have a drink afterwards? No, Jimmy left. Of course he did.
He left early. So where's Jimmy? He's gone.
Yeah. He will still be furious. No, it's true. Of course, White doesn't drink anymore.
Stephen has his red wine. So sorry. I'm just coming to you.
You've been heavily involved. A reminder, there are some... bits where you're meant to interact. No, it's all right. You keep apologising, but you keep coming back. It is an interesting question, Stephen. Obviously, the Masters reflects who the top 16 are, and quite a few of the people are people like Williams or Higgins that have been the same names for years. If we're here in another 5 years, are there players that you reckon we'd be seeing in the Masters then that we're only just seeing the best of now?
Well, I mean, we talk about Williams, like the class of 92, Williams, Higgins, O'Sullivan. I think they're all 48 now. Will they still be here at 53 in the Masters? It would be incredible. I would doubt whether all three will still be in the top 16.
Surely not, yeah.
But then you look down, I mean, obviously I watch a lot of snooker now, working on it, and I'm still struggling to see who's going to take over for them because they still play so well.
Yeah, I mean, Williams is getting better, if anything.
Exactly. And I think all three of them don't practice the way they used to practice. They basically turn up. They maybe put some preparation before the big events, but they don't put in the 5, 6, 7 hours a day that they used to do. So maybe that's allowing them to sort of prolong their career. But I mean, they're still playing a standard that is just, you know, I don't see, you know, people say, who's the youngsters coming along that you think is going to take over from the old guy? And I've not seen many. You've got the likes of Stan Moody, who's looks a good prospect, but still got to prove himself.
Yeah.
Who else is coming along? We'll wait and see.
Yeah, well, I'm asking you.
I know, and I'm asking you back.
It's like, answer is not many.
It's like, but yeah, I mean, it's
will we be here in 30 years' time and an 80-year-old Mark Williams is still bossing it?
Please God, no. Please God, no.
I wouldn't be too surprised. Turning up in his sports car, he's no longer legally entitled to drive. Well, we'll see. Obviously, we'll see. Is there a sense that players are keen to find form in this one as well, to put down a marker for, obviously we're not that far off from the Crucible and everything?
I think when you get to the turn of the year, you start to, as far as I did, I start to look ahead. You know, the Crucible was always in the distance. Mm. You're sort of three, maybe 4 months away from going there, and you know, you want to be obviously going there in your best form. But this tournament itself is so big, and I think you know, going back to Ronnie, I think these are the tournaments he really wants to win, the majors, the Triple Crown events. Yeah. I think this is what he wants, to win as many of these as possible before he finally, you know, hangs up his cue.
We've reached a point where, and this may or may not be a good idea, I ask audience members for their tips on who's going to win. So anyone got a prediction? And this involves me actually coming with this mic up to you. So who would like to make a case for who they think will win the Masters? Right at the back there, almost couldn't be worse for me.
Oh, that could be horrible.
Fine. Yes, sir.
I don't know if you will, but I'd really like Lisowski to win. Like, he was really good in that Macau thing, but I just feel like Neil Folds and people is down on him. It'd just be really cool if he won.
Yeah, this conversation about whether Lisowski's going to win one must be getting quite tiresome for him now.
Yeah, and I think he's like a bit of a crowd favourite when he gets going, like touch of the Jimmies and stuff about him. People like it. It's a bit more unpredictable. It's exciting.
Yeah.
Some of the recent ones have been a bit more boring, so I'd like it.
I'd love Jack to win it too. I mean, he's one of my favourite players to watch. He plays the game so beautifully. He hits the ball. His technique. He hits the ball as well as anyone. And basically, I mean, he's left-handed. Basically, he looks a mirror image of Ronnie when they're down on the table. The way they play. But there's obviously got to be, you know, it's getting hard. It's going to be harder and harder and harder for him to win because it's just going on so long. And everyone, we're talking about it. Everyone's talking about it. Like, I'm in the studio tomorrow when he plays Luca Brasil, and we'll be talking about it. You know, is this going to be the one? You know, I thought Macau, maybe in the final against Mark Williams, I thought that was going to be the one. I don't think it matters what he wins. It's just he needs to win something to get that feeling, get that belief. Because there's no doubt if he wins one tournament, he'll win many more. Be amazing this week, but I would doubt it. I think he'll win tomorrow. I think he'll beat Luca, but whether he wins is debatable.
I feel like I should tell you that Rob Walker said, after I've introduced you two, I'm off to film a Lukowski piece. So he may, for all we know, be in the building here. So we should just be careful about how we talk about him. Any snooker player could be prowling anywhere here.
I will say one thing, because people say to me, why is Jack not winning? Is it his bottle? Is he bottling it? And it's not his bottle. He's not throwing. It's not like he's, you know, you'll say, oh, he's choked there. It's not. It's just he needs to find some way of focusing, of concentrating. It seems to disappear, and that's not pressure. It's just a thing that he think he's had, and that's what he needs to look at.
Anyone else got either a forecast for the Masters winner or a wish for someone to win it, or yeah, I suppose just any other business really? Takes me precariously close to the Glaswegian.
Based on his performance over the last season or so, I really thought that Ding Junhui seems to be back to his form.
Yeah.
I was kind of disheartened when I saw that he drew Ronnie in the first round, which obviously has been a hang-up for him in the past.
Yeah.
But if he could get through that first round match against Ronnie, I'd fancy him to then just go through the whole thing.
I think Ding still. We're going to have Zhang Anda as a guest tonight, who's had an unbelievable season.
That was a secret. It's looking a lot like it is Zhang Anda now. Yeah.
So forget you heard that. Forget that.
We're going to have a Chinese player of some kind.
Yeah. But Ding is still, in my opinion, by far the best Chinese player that's ever been. Yeah, the UK, he showed signs of getting right back to his best, which is great for Ding, great for obviously snooker in China as well. And you're right, if he beats Ronnie, what the confidence he would get for that would be incredible.
But hand on heart, can he beat Ronnie in a first round situation?
He's beaten Ronnie many times. Not recently though, that's the thing. I mean, he's beaten him in Sheffield, he's beaten him in the UK Championship 6-0, I think, last year. Hmm. I think it's... We don't really know what to expect with Ronnie. How is he going to play? But I go back to what I said before. Even when he's not playing well, he seems to want to find that victory somehow. So tough draw for Ding. Tough draw. And this crowd obviously is going to be all for Ronnie as well. You've got to cope with that. Not only playing Ronnie, but cope with the crowd.
I will take one more non-Ronnie prediction. Well, you could just say Ronnie.
Go on, Ronnie.
There we go. You're the problem. Back up we go. Yeah, he's difficult to beat. There's no doubt about it.
Would there be a surprise if Barry Hawkins came through and did it? Because whenever Barry Hawkins is discussed, everybody talks about how he's a solid player, he's reliable, dependable, he's often under the radar. Yeah. We've seen great performances from him in finals in the 5 or 6 centuries in the Tour of Players a few years ago. Been to 2 finals, potentially out of form, Robbo to start. Mm-hmm. If he got there, how surprised would we be?
It wouldn't be a surprise. It's amazing to think that every tournament Barry's not considered as one of the 3 or 4 favourites, because he's got a great track record in the Triple Crown events. Finals of the World Championship, finals here. And he's already won this season, so he's got that confidence of having a victory under his belt. And arguably, as you say, a decent draw in the first round. Pretty out of sorts, maybe rusty, maybe a bit cold, Neil Robertson. So... No, it wouldn't be a surprise, but he's not one of the players I think about at the start of these tournaments as a potential winner.
Welcome back to Snooker Club Live from Alexandra Palace with me, Mark Watson, and Seth. We keep talking about it, 7-time world champion, Stephen Hendry. I have to always say that as if I'm not going to win 7, and maybe I'm not going to win 7. It's time to welcome our special guest now, a man who, well, needs no introduction, but he does, because if you're listening to this, you can't see who it is. Clearly, he needs an introduction. It's a podcast. An actor, comedian, and author who came to prominence as one half, this is a huge spoiler, of the double act Fry and Laurie. So we're down to 2 people it could be now. Left us in stitches with his performances in Blackadder, and more recently, this does narrow it down to 1, hosted QI for over a decade, also a very long time snooker fan, and a man familiar to all of you, Stephen Fry!
Very much. Oh, my goodness.
Hello, Stephen. How are you?
I'm very well, Mark. I'm excited to be here, to be honest.
Yes, your snooker fandom is genuine, isn't it?
It truly is. I mean, almost as long as I can remember. I mean, I remember watching documentaries about snooker before snooker was a television sport. You'd see John Spencer, players like that, the Davises, the Davis brothers, Joe Davis and his
wife. And Fred Davis.
And there'd be little things of smoke-filled rooms in Leicester Square where the first championships were. No one else in the audience is old enough to remember any of that, I'm sure. But then slowly the news came out of Alex Higgins and John Spencer, and he played, and Ray Reardon, and he played. And he became a story. There was a famous Sunday Times Magazine article about him, and people began to be curious, and I was always curious because I played the game, because I don't know if anybody here agrees, but there is a magnetic quality to a snooker table, and when you're a child, you see it, you desperately want You just cannot wait to pick up a cue and push it through and make a ball move. I mean, it's a thrilling thing to do. It's a primal action, and it's not natural, it doesn't exist in nature, and yet somehow it pulls on our brains.
Yeah, our cavemen forefathers weren't playing snooker.
Well, when you think about it, we've had the darts here, and the darts is archery brought indoors for the winter, because you can't, you know, it's too wet and cold to do a bow and arrow, so you do a little version for the indoors. And snooker is bowls. You know, Francis Drake's game brought indoors with a green lawn made of bays, and it has to be pushed with sticks because you can't bowl it with your hands.
We're going to be playing later with Stephen and Zhang, and we might wish that we'd never had that impulse.
what was it like seeing Alex Higgins for the first time? Because obviously he was completely different to the establishment.
Completely extraordinary. And that was the story about him from the beginning, that he was this outsider from Northern Ireland. Mm. People compared him to George Best, of course, simply because he came from the same region. And he always looked lonely and haunted with his sucked-in cheeks. Yeah. But then you saw this bizarre style, this weird, you know, cue action with flying up in the air, the shoulder he put into it. And the people he were playing with their velvet bow ties, perimons, people like
that. I was wondering how they got the cue past them, because they were huge.
Absolutely.
Like giant bats on their neck. It was like...
They really were, weren't they? And it was, and he had frilly shirts then as well.
That's right.
It was, I mean, the phrase breath of fresh air was always used about it.
Did you ever meet him?
No, I never did. Right. I never did. I'm sort of glad because
probably
would have been awfully rude to me or something.
It's hard to imagine two more different people than you and Alex Higgins.
Well, actually, no, Steve Davis is. And that then became
the rivalry.
One of the stories about sport is always, you know, the classicist versus the romantic.
Mm. Yeah.
And whether it's Borg versus McEnroe or something, you know, you get this fantastic sense of a natural talent, explosive personality, dangerous, dark, difficult, against a kind of machine who's technically brilliant and who's focused. And you can support both. You don't, you know, it's not like one is terrible. You were both.
Yeah, if you love snooker, you appreciate how both players play the game.
And you were both, because you were an attacking player, but you were also immensely technically, you know, gifted. And so that's what I guess made you workable. Were. Sorry, that's awful. One word. I'm so sorry. Obviously not true now.
Well, we'll see. We'll see on the table. So you've witnessed, without wanting to make you feel old, almost the complete history of snooker as the game that we know it.
Absolutely, yes.
And how do you feel about the health of the game now in that context?
It's terrific. What Stephen was saying about the class of 92 is interesting, because you also hear people from inside snooker saying that there's an extraordinary richness of young people coming through. Wow. And again, talking about the darts, we looked at Luke Littler and thought, you know, not since Ronnie O'Sullivan burst into snooker has there been a young talent like that. And there doesn't really seem to be yet someone who is making us really sit up and take notice.
It is worth talking about, actually. Luke Littler, obviously, if you're not aware, got all the way to the World Darts Final as a 16-year-old. And we've talked quite a bit on this podcast about the fact that there's a lot of young talent, but is it more difficult in snooker for somebody to come from nowhere like that? Or could we see that happen, do you think?
I think if you've got the talent, you're going to come through. And obviously, Luke Littler is obviously an outrageous talent. And if someone comes through that young, that talented in snooker, they're going to come through because they're that good. I've yet to see someone with that prodigious talent coming through in snooker. I was 18, I think, when I won my first major tournament. I look younger than Luke Littler did.
Well,
he's not 16.
I mean,
he's not 16. I'm not having it.
Everyone looks younger than he. Yeah. Stephen, the other Stephen, you'll remember witnessing Stephen Hendry's
absolutely, and of
ascent.
Course, we've all seen the documentaries where you're sulking with your manager.
Well, that was my default look, to sulk. Even when I won, I was sulking.
Absolutely. But no, I remember you coming on, and it was remarkable. But then I remember on Pot Black, a sort of 10-year-old John Parrott.
Yeah.
Who looked exactly like John Parrott.
John Parrott, yeah.
His hairline has not moved.
No, exactly. Yeah,
I suppose the thing we saw with Luke Littler and the thing we recognising great snooker players, it's not only the talent for the game, the way the ball is struck, it's the mental power to concentrate. What you said about Jack Mazowski, and particularly the Worlds, which is, I mean, how you
so
keep
long,
that
yeah,
so many matches. I can't remember how many frames you have to play in order to win the World Championship. Yeah. It's astonishing.
The thing about Luke Littler, I was going to say, I mean, apart from the talent he obviously has, how he enjoyed the pressure, how he enjoyed being up there. That's because that's half the battle. Absolutely. Not just having the talent. That's, I've heard throughout my whole snooker career, people say, oh, you should see this guy play. He's 14, he makes 10 centuries a day. I say, oh, I look forward to seeing him. And you never see it because they can do it there, but they can't do it,
that's it,
where it matters.
And I used to play regularly in the late 80s and early 90s in a private members club in London called the Groucho Club. And there was a group of us who were very sort of that age, I suppose. There was the artist Damien Hirst, who, as you probably know, is a very, very passionate snooker lover and a great personal close friend of Ronnie, and a sort of advisor to Ronnie. Alex James from Blur was there, Keith Allen, the actor, and a few others. We would play almost
quiet night then.
It was afternoon. We would start at about 2 in the afternoon, go on to 4 in the morning.
It's lucky that place is still standing there based on everyone you've met so far.
Sleeping under the table. A thing that I will never forget, because it's so true, and this is all about me, but it's all about my failure as a sportsman of any kind, is that I was playing Damien, and I was like 30 up, and there were the colours, only the colours, maybe one red. And Damien picked up his cue, and he looked at me and said, you do know you're going to lose, don't you? I said, what do you mean? He said, you just don't have the killer instinct.
Really?
And I do, and I'm going to beat you. I said, don't say that. And he did.
Really?
Which made his point for him.
I don't know, and he snookered me.
You got in your head, though.
Yeah. Absolutely fell to pieces. And I mean, this is just in a club with no audience watching, but there is still that. It's that self-consciousness, isn't it? And you see it in Steve Davis, funnily enough, as a player. Yeah. He was always self-conscious, wasn't he?
Yeah.
You always saw it when he was sitting, that he knew people were watching him.
Yeah.
And you didn't. You went into your zone and you were just there.
Yeah.
And I always felt for Steve for that how could he snap out of it? Obviously, he had a supreme career and didn't need sympathy, but it was a very noticeable thing.
And now a DJ.
Fascinating.
You mentioned Blur. He opened for Blur at Wembley Stadium.
Yes, he did.
The most random thing I think I've ever heard.
We never stop talking about it. It's absolutely mad.
It is amazing.
It's as if you heard that Coldplay had Tony Drago or something. It's just like,
that would be less odd. Really.
In a way, it would be, yeah. Is there a type of person, do you think, Stephen, that has that mentality? Like, I'm going to beat you, or is it something that you evolve over time?
It's something you can't practice, obviously. You can't teach that. The thing is, and it's what separates the best from the rest. Yeah. You know, if everyone could do it under the pressure, then it would be easy. My finals with Jimmy, for example, I used to always be able to tell that when he was under pressure, and I could almost project my confidence onto him, kind of thing, and it's the whole psychology of the sport. A big talent, sort of, at that level, at that stage of match, goes out the window, kind of.
Yes, and you can see it. One of the glories of snooker is because the cameras are so close. You can see the moment that the game face and the being in the zone is removed from the player, and suddenly they're not concentrating properly, or that strange mixture that you have to concentrate. But you also have to be, to some extent, relaxed.
Right.
If you concentrate without being relaxed, you're forced. If you're relaxed without concentrating, you're all over the place. Right. But when they come together, and you can see it in the faces, and you go, oh my God, he's lost it. Or, oh my God, he's got it back. It's really fascinating, isn't it? There are very few other sports where you get that close into the personality and the mood of the player.
And where it goes on so long as well, those World Championship finals are real epics of psychology, because, in fact, we've never talked about it directly, but those finals with Jimmy, especially the one where you came back from, one in particular where you came back from a long way back, do you remember thinking, I'm in trouble here, or did you always continue to feel that there is something here that's going to... How much do you reflect on the situation in the match when you're in it?
I mean, I was 14-8 down, and you think, you're not really thinking about winning, really, because you're just so far behind.
Yeah.
Jimmy needs 4 frames for victory. But something inside, the beauty of the World Championship, the long frame matches, is is momentum plays a huge part.
So and if I kind you can of win just, one, you
yeah,
start.
Yeah, I sort of clung to the thing where if I can win one, maybe two frames in a row, yeah. I can kind of not only get momentum on my own, but put doubt in his mind. And it came, I think I won the last two or three frames of the session to finish 14-10. And I kind of knew, I could sense it. I knew, but then I still needed to win the first frame of the evening session, because if Jimmy won it, then he would have gone on. But yeah, momentum plays a huge part in the long matches.
I noticed in the UK and a few of the other matches that there's a new thing. A lot of the players now just look the other way when their opponent is playing. Yeah. They almost make a point of pretending to look at another game going on at another table, and it's rather transparently pathetic.
it's the thing about these multi-table venues.
Yes.
As you can be distracted, but I agree that they're like pretend. It's completely false. Yeah. It's like they're so disgusted by their own that they can't. You know, I don't really care what's going on, but really they are absolutely human. Human.
And they're listening to the timing of every shot absolutely. On their own game. Yeah. Do you look into the eyes of? I mean, did you sneak looks at your player or their body language?
Yeah. You would kind of try and do it very sneakily with Jimmy without, well, I mean, don't give away too much. It's gone now, who cares? It's back in the 90s. But I would always, I knew he was under pressure. He started hitting the balls a bit harder. And I thought, okay, his timing would go first. And then I think, okay, that's a good sign. And he would maybe sweat a bit more. He'd be constantly doing this and just little signs. Every player has had little, as you say, tells like in poker. Yeah. Not everyone. I mean, Steve was, you'd get nothing from Steve. Nothing. Nice. I mean, at any stage. Yeah. I mean, no, you wouldn't get a hello. I mean, it's like, but.
I read the other day, or I'm imagining it, just sort of talking with the really great old players, that Ray Reardon got a century the other
unbelievable.
Day.
Incredible. He's 90 something, I think.
What?
Incredible. Phenomenal.
Incredible. Unbelievable.
Incredible. Maybe he is a vampire. Maybe he is. He's just like.
That's certainly one explanation. Yeah. The reds are just blood.
But
to him.
I mean, yeah, to make 100 break in 90, I mean, it's phenomenal. Phenomenal.
We'd all be happy with that, I think.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah.
In a match or just on the...
I don't think he plays matches in a while. I don't know, but...
I don't think he's in the Masters, for example. Well,
I think it's... I'm glad to be alive in 19. I remember making century breaks.
Remarkable, yeah. And incredible. I suppose that mentality must never...
Well, he was a serious competitor, Ray Reardon. He was, I mean, the stories, the other sort of the Dennises and the Cliff Thorburn tell about Ray, I mean, he was... His gamesmanship and everything was... Phenomenal.
He disguised it with a sort of jokey, but my goodness, you could read under it.
Yeah.
Ferocity.
Phenomenal.
What sort of gamesmanship?
He would try and maybe start get the crowd involved. Yeah. If he was a pressure, he'd maybe try and make someone laugh, which, you know, would make, take, you know, maybe his opponent might laugh, and then all of a sudden his concentration's broken. Just little tiny things. Clever, very clever.
The games were so long in those days as well.
Oh, God. I think he played Alex Higgins in a final that was over 5 days, and Alex conceded on the third day or something.
Went home.
Still 2 days to go, which, phenomenal.
Test cricket.
Phenomenal.
The Masters is best of 21, isn't it?
This week is best of 11, but first of 11 until the final is best of 19.
Best of 19?
Best of 19, yeah.
So you've not been to the Masters before, have you, Stephen?
But you've been to the Crucible, because I met you at the Crucible.
I've been to the Crucible, certainly.
Oh, no,
I went to the Masters
here,
at Wembley. Yeah. I used to, when I was starting out in comedy, the BBC used to have a Christmas party every year, the Light Entertainment Christmas party. And I remember going, and you'd be very excited because you'd see the two Ronnies or something, and Ernie Wise or something. And it'd be really, really thrilling. But I remember that I think the second year I went, I saw John Virgo standing alone. And being a snooker fan, because I leapt up to him, and he was at the LE party, the Light Entertainment party, because of Big Break, you know, the Jim Davison thing that he used to do. And he very kindly invited me along to Wembley for a few years in a row. And I remember that atmosphere you were talking about when Jimmy came on. It was absolutely astonishing, astonishing. And I can imagine it's pretty similar here with Ronnie.
There was one time at Wembley Conference Centre, I was playing Jimmy. And they had this MC who was very well-spoken, Norman de Mesquite or something his name was. And it was very proper, the introductions. And he introduced, and Jimmy's at the bottom, and said he's basically got 2,800 Londoners waiting to roar. I said, and Stephen's opponent from London, Jimmy Brown. Unlucky. Jimmy, he was fuming, Jimmy, when it was, honestly, basically, he was fuming.
If that's your job, you've got to get the names of the
players.
Biggest
anti-climax of all, so, it was like...
Talking of these, so what's your view on the slow move towards the darts play on, the nicknames? Who right. thinks up a new player comes on? What's his nickname going to be?
Yeah.
What's their play on music going to be? Yeah. How much of a light show? You know, it's getting more and more towards that. I don't mind it. I mean, I think it's...
I think tournaments like the World Championship should be left alone because that is a World Championship. But I think there's room for all sorts, I think, because every sport is moving forward and changing. So snooker's is no different. But I think things like the Triple Crown events are special and should be maybe above.
Yeah, in the same way as a test match.
Of course.
You keep your whites on.
Yeah.
It's only in the one days you wear the pajamas. Yeah.
Definitely, yeah. what would your nickname be, Mark? Do you think on the back of it?
Well, some of the names are quite tenuous, aren't they? I remember from Bristol that you could do the pistol from Bristol or something, but Trump has already got
Mark Allen's a pistol, yeah.
I know, that's the thing.
And he's a name I would want to bring up as a possible winner, by the way.
Yes.
Mark Allen.
Yeah.
When he's...
But Allen's from Northern Ireland, he doesn't even deserve to be called, he doesn't even rhyme with Bristol.
No.
He's got no right to that. But he's also called Mark.
With all respect to the great Mark Selby, I don't think of him as a jester.
No.
So, it's now time to open up the discussion once again to our live audience. For good or ill, I was going to say. But first, a couple of emails. Thank you for being in touch at, as always, snookerclub@wst.tv. We can't read every email straight away, so if you don't hear your message, be patient. This email from Tom, firstly, a big thank you for the podcast. It's absolutely tremendous. We always start with one of those. We've not yet read one that said, I hate this podcast. But while you're here, a combination of the pod and Stephen's fantastic YouTube channel have stirred the embers of an old passion I had. There you go.
Excellent.
And then, this is quite a niche question, I think, but worth asking. My question is, this is from Tom, during a match, do you share a toilet with your opponent? It must be awkward standing next to each other at the urinals. Also, do any of the top 16 not wash their hands reliably?
Well, we've seen in Ronnie's documentary, he doesn't wash his hands.
We've heard all about it.
But I will tell you, the UK Championship, the Guildhall, it's not played at Guildhall
Impressive.
Anymore. Yeah. So, yeah. Steve Davis, before matches, whether he was nervous or whatever, would always go to the toilet. And you didn't want to go in there after him. Let's just put it that way. There you go.
There we go.
And there was only one toilet, so it wasn't wasn't great.
Yes, fairly slightly run down venue that. There we go. So I hope that's what you're after.
Too much
Tom.
Information there, really. There, but I just thought I'd share it.
Borderline too much information, but it was sort of what Tom was asking. So there you go. And that's why they don't use the Guildhall anymore. Toilet ruined forever by Steve Davis. I had the. We often read out emails from people that have met Stephen or me, and by Stephen or me, I mean Stephen. No one's ever boasted that they've met me yet. I had the pleasure of meeting Stephen back in 2002 when he came to Spencer's Club in Stirling, well, that was your local, to present the trophies to all the Scottish juniors. Stephen was my idol growing up. To meet him was a dream come true. On the debate of greatest of all time, 5, Williams, 4, Davis, despite his toilet stuff. I mean, this person didn't say that, obviously. 3, Higgins, 2, O'Sullivan, 1, Hendry. Stephen came along, this person's up there with her in terms of fandom. Stephen came along, he completely changed the game into a version that no one had ever seen before. To this day, the majority of players break build and open the pack early because of Hendry's influence. So there you are. How do you respond to the charge that you are the most influential snooker player of all time?
I'm obviously very flattered. I did play a game that was very, very aggressive compared to the other players around at the time. But now all the players are just so aggressive in the way they play.
Do you think, you famously have mastered the, going off the blue into the pink to split the pack. Do you think with the slower cloths 4 or 5 years before you, those shots would have worked as well?
It's a good question, actually. The balls as well would have made a difference. Yeah. They might not have split open as the cloths are so super slick now. The balls just open quite without much effort. But you're right. I just think what People say I invented the shot. I didn't. Steve was playing that shot. Other players were playing it. But maybe I played it earlier in the frame than other players would. I think maybe that's the way I changed it.
We now have a moment where audience members can ask questions of, either of the Stevens. Anyone got a question? We'll go, yes. Oh, yeah, sorry. Shall I let you tee that one up? And in the meantime, we'll go towards the back here. Yes, hi.
Hi, Stephen.
Hi.
That could be either Stephen.
Mr. Hendry.
Definitely Hendry.
Seven times world champion, you dominated the sport in the 90s. Is there a part of you, though, that would have liked to be in your prime today? With the big money tournaments in China and the way crowds are now?
There's obviously more tournaments now. There's more tournaments around the world. I mean, it's incredible now if you're a snooker professional now that the choice that you've got to play. But no, I think I came into the game at an incredible time. It was huge on TV, sort of late 80s, early 90s. It was everywhere. Snooker players were arguably some of the most famous sportsmen out there. It was so high profile, and through the 90s, I think it was a golden age for snooker. So no, I wouldn't change my time. To me, I mean, what I do miss, I tell her, I don't miss practicing 5-6 hours a day. I don't miss a lot of the things, but I do miss the walking out. I mean, the players that get to walk out of this arena this week, the atmosphere, you never miss. You never stop missing that.
And now we've got your question over here.
Have you seen Ronnie O'Sullivan's documentary? If so, what did you make of it?
I have seen it. I was at the premiere.
We discussed this on the previous episode. He was almost the only famous person then not to get a shout out.
Yeah, it was. I enjoyed it. Yeah, I thought it was great. Some of the stuff in it was a revelation to me. I mean, how gone he was in the dressing room prior to going out the final session was incredible. He was in bits basically. So for him to turn that around and actually get the victory was phenomenal, really. But yeah, I thoroughly enjoyed it.
And the footage of his father and himself as a boy, and it was very moving. It really was. I mean, because whatever I think about him, and I'm sure some players must hate him sometimes because of the way he sucks all the energy into himself and the way the crowd are always behind him and the fact that he is a bit flaky sometimes and says he doesn't care when he obviously does. And all those problems, but you look at his childhood and you forgive him everything, really. I mean, it's just an extraordinary story.
Yep.
I read your review of his autobiography, in fact.
Oh, yes.
It's quite some book, isn't it?
It really is, yeah.
Yeah. I just think most people here will be, if you haven't read it, O'Sullivan's story is well worth it. And the documentary, of course, is quite something, any more questions? Well, yeah, that's perfectly located for me, really.
I'd like to apologise to you for hating you. I'm an Alex Higgins fan. I've played Alex.
Yeah.
My mum's met Alex.
Okay.
I'm a Jimmy White fan. I've played Jimmy. That's my sort of game. So when you were beating Steve Davis, I couldn't stand him.
Right.
And I couldn't stand you. It works out. Steve Davis is a great DJ.
Yeah. Thank you. Not at all. It's incredible the amount of people actually that have said that during the 90s. I'm sure Steve had the same that during the 90s. Like they'll, you know, I wanted Jimmy to win so much, and you were sort of the enemy. It was the same with Alex. I mean, I tell a story. When I turned pro at 16, Alex Higgins used to always want to practice with me. He'd come and practice. And I was like, oh my God, practicing with Alex Higgins, incredible. But then I started to win, and then I became the enemy.
Yeah.
It's like you were saying with the establishment, Steve. It was the same thing. He didn't want anything to do with me then. He hated me then. It was like, you know, but...
There's a hint of WWE, isn't there? You've got to have the heel in the wrestling. You've got the villain.
One of the things I saw was Steve Davis stuck on a plane beside Alex Higgins, and he was absolutely... beside himself, distraught. Like, oh my God,
I was
sitting beside him.
Yeah, and I think that story, I think he actually had a good time, actually. He was petrified, but I think they ended up having a good time. And Steve always tells a joke about that, you know, I was coming out of a nightclub and these three or four guys were started setting about me and beat me up. He says for about 5 minutes, then Alex comes around the corner and says, okay boys, that's enough. Steve tells that story at the exhibition.
Yes, come on. Yes, your moment has come.
After listening to
Let me give you the microphone.
Honestly, I read your book 5-10 years ago, and honestly, from a Scots girl, from a Scottish man, it was phenomenal.
Thank you very much.
A down to earth story, and I was so proud to be a Scottish girl, to see a Scottish man do what he did, and I just, it's phenomenal.
Thank you very much.
You've done so much.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Wasn't it Alan McManus who broke your run?
And it was. And I love Alan McManus.
So if you just tuned in, Stephen is Scottish.
Hi, Stephen. Your cue, which you got broken, was broken.
Yeah.
Was it Hong Kong?
Yeah, it was Thailand. Yeah.
What effect did that have on your career? Did it stall from that kind of point on?
Quite a big effect. It shouldn't really be. I mean, you would think you should be skillful enough to be able to lose a cue and take another cue and just as well. But I won 70 tournaments with that cue and won 5 after obviously all my world titles. I think because it was such a bad cue. I mean, it was a cheap cue. It was like 30. It was Ben. It was like, I think my dad bought it was 30 quid, whereas now you can upwards of, you can spend £5,000-£7,000 on cues.
There are rock guitarists like that, aren't there, whose first guitar is the one they stay with, and then it breaks, and then they're never the same.
It just when I got cues after, it just felt different, and when that happens, it's almost in a tournament under pressure. And you go in a practice table and you say, oh, this is a century, then no problem. But then when you face that first sort of pressure shot, all of a sudden you think, what is this, man? This doesn't feel right. And it's more mental than physical.
Have we even considered that Davis smashed it? Or Jimmy, or one of these people? It's all a bit convenient.
So we're in a beautiful room in Alexandra Palace today. As both a fan and a player, how much does the sense of venue, the city, the physical building you're in, change how a tournament feels for you, for both of you, really, I guess?
Well, speaking for myself, I mean, I always, venues is quite important, really. I always felt that theatres, where we used to play a lot on in the 90s, we used to have, the Assembly Rooms in Derby, the Hexagon Theatre, Reading. Yeah. It was always theatres where if you went to a leisure centre, which was the seats would be put in, it was like, it just didn't seem to have that aura to me, the Crucible Theatre, obviously, here. It's just different. You need to have that inspiration, really, I think, to walk in the place.
Yeah. All actors and performers will talk about this theatre being a good comedy theatre, or a good straight drama theatre. There is something very special about places. They have real qualities, like people. And certainly as a, I don't know if Mark would agree, but in terms of theatres, rather pleasingly, it's the ones with a sort of little circle, which I call a smile, which is where you see the audience in a, and you feel a little bit closer to them, rather than a more of a bowling alley or a square. And there you really tend to connect, and there's a much better atmosphere. So it's a very good question. Because place has an enormous kind of, there's a vibe.
It's time now to welcome our second guest of the evening. Not really clear which of these chairs he'll sit on.
go next to Steve. Yeah.
Okay, fine, that's taken that weight off my mind. A man who has been in the form of his life this season, winner at the International Championship in Tianjin, leaving him third on the one-year list, only behind Judd and Ronnie O'Sullivan, also making his Masters debut this year. Make some noise for Zhang Anda!
Hi.
How are you doing?
Not bad.
And that's all we've got time for. How was your Christmas? Did you have you been home or did you?
Yeah,
stay?
Just back to China. Yeah, see my family.
Yeah, great.
Yeah.
And how are you feeling about the Masters?
First, very happy. Now it's top 16, and very happy first time being here.
Yeah,
but you must have watched the Masters so many times on TV and thought, I want to play in that event.
Yeah, I just remember yours.
tell Mark about the match you remember of mine in the Masters. It's not the six victories, by the way.
Yeah, I remember. He played Mark William.
Yeah.
He's so happy.
It's just nice to hear about him losing sometimes.
Yeah.
You've had an amazing season.
Yeah.
Do you think you're doing anything differently, or why? You know, where has this form come from?
I don't know.
Yeah. Fair enough.
Yeah. Just every single day, just do same. Just practice harder. Yeah. Maybe just my time coming.
It shows how confidence means so much in every sport, and you must have, by getting the wins, become so confident. Winning the international championship, how much losing, getting to the final, but losing to Judd Trump, was that experience help to win the next tournament?
Yes. It's very good experience. Mm. And second time I played the final, when I score lead, I still tell myself, calm, relax, still concentrate the table.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So having played one final, you just feel more like, okay, you know what to do here.
But one of Zhang Anda's strengths is you don't show any emotion at any stage. I've watched you a bit in the UK Championship.
That's close, sort of close thing Hendry
enjoys. Yeah. When I see someone just having that level, in a bad shot, good shot, doesn't matter. Even you made 147 in the final in Tianjin.
Yeah.
You didn't show much emotion.
Because I like you.
I always say being happy is overrated.
Yeah.
You know, showing this joy is
pretty. You've paved the way for a generation of emotionless snooker players, Steve. Of course, you two played in the Crucible in 2010.
Yeah.
And do you remember that game, Jack? Well, you must have done it.
My first season. And I remember I was 9-7 up. I just lost. So sad.
to go back,
another dream ruined by Hendry.
All through the match, though, I kept on leaving Anda like long shots, and he kept on dropping them in dead weight for the black. Whereas if you play it slowly, you're going to miss it. You're going to leave it on if you miss. And in a deciding frame, again, I left him this red. I thought, oh no, he's going to drop this in again for the black. He played it so close, and I just stayed over the pocket, and I managed to make a break to win.
I think I just potted that red.
Yeah.
I just move my body. See again, it's missed.
Yeah. Has Ding been a big influence? Because you play and live in Sheffield, I think, is that right?
Yeah.
Like a lot of other players from China.
Yeah.
And is he like a kind of mentor, a guide, an inspiration for you?
Yes.
He is?
Yes.
Yeah. And he helps. Does you practice with him?
Oh, with Ding?
Yeah.
No.
No, you don't.
Wouldn't dream of it.
Different academy.
Oh, it's a different academy.
Yeah,
is it?
Yeah,
oh,
yeah.
I see. Yeah.
Have you spent time in China, Stephen?
I've been, yes. I've been to Beijing and to Shanghai, and I love it. Absolutely love it. Fantastic.
How do you find being? Because your wife and son are in China, and you have to spend so much time in the UK. How does that affect you? Does it affect you? Or?
Just every day, just FaceTime.
Okay.
Yeah.
But it cannot be easy.
Yes. Very tough.
What are your predictions for the Masters, Andy? Who do you think are the big players?
Big players?
Yeah, who's going to win? I mean, I know you're in the tournament, so it's difficult.
John Higgins?
My idol.
John Higgins is Zhang Anda's idol.
Yeah, I've seen you say that Higgins is your hero.
I very, very like him.
So if you have to play John Higgins, how do you stop the admiration. You have to be serious.
No, I just want to be him.
Okay. Simple enough. Again, a man after your heart, yeah.
But now, like 10 years, my play professional is 10 years, but I never play with.
You really? Never met Higgins?
Yeah. No.
No. So it could happen here. Yeah. Are you in the same half of the draw, I wonder?
Do you know the draw? Do you know if you?
I've got it here somewhere.
But you play at Sean Murphy tomorrow night.
Yes.
You're confident? Because he plays quite an attacking game. So you think you'll get chances?
Still big challenge for me. Mm-hmm. And I just try to do my best. Mm-hmm.
So. You're in the other half of the draw from Higgins, so it would need to be the final. Yeah. Imagine that. I mean, it must be very exciting, the whole thing.
Yes.
When you wouldn't have imagined you would be at the Masters.
Well, maybe a first time final, Master final, I can play my idol. It's amazing. Mm.
Yeah. But at the start of the season, if someone had said to you, you're going to be final of the English Open, win the International Championship, make a 147 in the final, you're in the Masters, you're guaranteed top 16 in the Crucible, you're in everything. Would you say they were crazy, or would you think you expect it or not?
Very crazy.
Very crazy, very crazy. Yeah. Incredible season, season.
You didn't begin the season thinking you'd be sitting next to Stephen Fry. No one does. Ladies and gentlemen, Zhang Anda, and all the that's pretty much all from us here at Alexandra Palace. Thank you to all of the audience who become immediate gold honorary members of Snooker Club, and thank you to those listening to the podcast too. If you haven't already, please make sure you subscribe to Snooker Club wherever you get your podcasts, and you can head to WST's YouTube to watch the show back. We're back in our normal fortnightly Wednesday slot on the 17th of January. But for now, one last time, please put your hands together for Stephen Fry! Diana! Seven-time world champion Stephen Hendry. I've been Mark Watson. This is Snooker Club live from Alexandra Palace. See you soon.
Well done. Good luck tomorrow.